Okay,
There we are.
there
Now
we
we're
are.
live. I haven't even
Hello.
set anything up tonight, so.
Hi, Internet.
Hello, Internet! Right, so let me just. Hey, everyone, my name is Fraser Cain, publisher of Universe Today. You know the drill. This is Virtual Star Party. We hook up a bunch of telescopes, except we only have one telescope, and that's James McGee's beautiful view of the moon.
It
So
is.
instead of doing our normal Star Party where we switch back and forth to lots of telescopes, we thought we would just stick around for 5 minutes and show you this beautiful view of the moon. And then we'll probably we're going to have to wrap this up. Man, that's an amazing view of the moon, though. So we couldn't not show it. We got Gary
And you're
Gonella.
crying.
Hey, Gary, can you show us your night
Hi guys,
sky there?
doing it right now.
All right. There's
Yeah.
my sky.
Womp, womp,
Womp.
womp.
Yeah.
It's a lot of nebulosity.
A lot of nebulosity there, yeah.
It
Yeah, for sure.
is.
Yeah, that's
We
the.
gotta get those new narrowband H2O filters.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, or fire up the weather machine. Scott
Or fire
Lewis.
up.
There's Scott. Womp, womp. And Tom Nathe. Hey, Tom.
I.
All right, well, we're going to go back to this view of the moon, and James can kind of pan this around a bit, maybe, and.
Yeah, and tell us what you're using tonight, James. Well, so this is your night to shine, James. It's all you, no pressure at
It's just
all.
it's just you and the tonight on the Virtual Star Party, an intimate
That's
view of the moon and James
right.
McGee.
Welcome to the
James,
intimate view of the moon.
tell us about the moon.
The moon is beautiful. It's fantastic, and we're watching it right now, live on Google Plus.
It's made of cheese,
Back to
right?
you, Fraser Cain.
Yeah. So
Fighting
no, we got to
crime
everyone
again.
just let us know over the evening. Can't. Well, I got bad skies. I got nothing. Although I think they're all just watching Cosmos.
I think that's
I'm
what it is.
say,
I think they're a bunch of
yeah.
slackers.
We're gonna be battling Cosmos every week, actually, for the next, what,
Hey,
13 weeks?
well,
How many weeks is
I
it?
think you
Nine
guys need to
weeks?
start making yourselves the after party. And like everyone show up here, have a drink. We're going to look at awesome stuff on the internet. Look at the cosmos after you're done, thinking and having your mind blown by Neil deGrasse Tyson. Well, here, let's give you some direct access to what's out there as well.
Yeah. So there you go. Live view of the moon. I've
I'll
enabled the Q&A
entertain you with a
app.
little bit of lightning. Where'd it
Ooh.
go?
There, yeah,
Is it on
exactly.
there?
I see it.
There it is. That's
Igor.
Gotta have lightning. There's no fun if you don't have lightning.
It's true.
What's that?
Kerostosthenes. Oh, that's the straight wall there.
Where?
Yeah.
Upper left corner.
Oh, yeah, there it is.
Well, there's this awesome app that I know of that I would really recommend you guys get if you want to become familiar with the moon. It's called Phases of the Moon. And it's by this kind of sketchy, source on the internet called Universe Today. So I wouldn't, I don't know who they are, but it's a pretty good resource if you
Yeah.
want.
You can get it from Google Plus or you
Google
can get it
Play.
from
Google Play for free.
Google Play, yep, for free, or you can get it from the iTunes store as well.
And actually, I don't know if I've re-downloaded this on my phone. I'm a bad person. It's on my tablet. But
Yeah.
it really is a good tool. I've actually used it in the planetary astronomy course that I taught for a while. And like, hey, look. And you can study, because I'm going to quiz you on the phases of the moon. And it does help. They do get to see how it works, especially
Can
with.
we go up to the top there, James, and we can see the limb there? It looks just like right on the Terminator there. This looks great.
Yeah.
The Terminator?
The Terminator. Look at that Terminator. And the straight wall. So what is the straight wall? Tom, do you have any idea what that is?
Yeah, it's a fault scarp. So that part of the moon, the geology, as the moon cooled off, that's part of an impact basin right there. So as that region cooled, one part of the moon went up and the other part went down. And you've created this little fault scarp. It's actually very shallow. You could walk right up that without too much trouble. It's like about a, I think about a 15-degree slope on the left-hand side there. So it's not that hard of a hike. But the actual fault itself goes, oh golly, it goes up screen, if you just make a straight line with the how the fault goes there now, it goes off screen, up, and a little bit further down on this overall.
Oh, here we go. And Russell is, it's also got the moon. Great. This is great. We got the moon.
In stereoscopic.
Stereoscopic moon, yeah. Put on your 3D glasses, and you'll be able to see the moon in thrilling 3D.
Dual-wielding moon.
And Peter's trying to join somewhere. I keep getting video calls from him.
Yeah.
We're over here.
I put the link, the link in the...
in our super secret private chat, where we get to hang out and talk.
Yeah. Yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah, now we're getting over to down into the Imbrium impact basin.
Is this starting to turn into an actual virtual star party?
I think so.
Uh-oh. I was so ready to go James, watch Cosmos.
James, if you could hold the view right there, that's an excellent example of the outer edge of an impact basin. You actually have three separate impact basins. You got the one up to the top, one on the bottom, and then if you look real carefully, the crater, the big crater in the middle with the debris off to the side, that's another impact basin. That's the outer edges of a earlier impact basin. So you have an asteroid, big old honking thing, probably 20, 30 miles across, impact into the moon, created a huge crater. Then over time, lava came up, welled up from the moon. This is billions of years ago, right? Not too long after the lunar formation. So you have lava coming up, and that's why this side of the moon, anyway, has all these seas, is all the lava that came up from the interior of the moon some 3 to 3.5 billion years ago.
If we're turning this into an actual virtual star party, I'm going to need links. If I'm going to work tonight, then I should actually start doing my job.
All right.
It's your guys' show, so you
worst
know.
Worst episode ever.
Well, let's see, Peter, are you bringing something in tonight, or are we just looking at your pretty face?
Yeah, I've got a couple of images. I just got a shot of Orion for you, and also got some information on Comet Sighting Spring, a couple of my images from the last couple of nights, if you're interested.
That means I got to work. All right, let's do this. This is going to be a real VSP tonight, kids.
I'm going to bail on you guys.
All right, Gary.
Okay, Gary.
Thanks as
See
always.
See you later.
Gary heard work, and he had to leave.
Yeah. All right, I will do some work, too. We're just gazing at this moon.
So for those of you not knowing what's going on, this is the work we do before we go live. We didn't actually expect to have an actual show tonight, but it's turning into one. So we're just going to be mumbling to ourselves while we're actually updating everything.
Enjoy this view of the moon.
And this is not too uncommon what happens in somebody's observatory. Everybody's trying to figure out what in the world to look at and what's up and what to do if the clouds start showing up.
Keep going, Tom. You're doing a great job.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, please. By all means, keep this chatter going.
Keep the chatter going. Okay.
Yeah.
For those who've never worked in an observatory, it's rather interesting because I have a small... or had a small observatory. I just had to sell it recently. Roll-off roof. It was pretty good sized, actually. It was almost 8 foot on a side, almost 2 meters on a side. And then I had my scope inside of that on a wedge and pier and all that good stuff. But, mostly you roll the roof off and you fire everything up. Hope that it works, because inevitably, at least for me in Oregon, it gets it can be several months between observing sessions. And you fire everything up, let the computer fire up, the scope settle in, and then you work through all whatever problems inevitably show up because you got everything sitting there. But Peter has a beautiful view of Orion, so I think I'll switch over to him.
Well, I didn't want to disturb you trying to talk.
Camera. Tom?
Pardon?
I'm the one who switches the camera.
Oh, because I just happened to see it come up. So yeah.
Now you can look at whatever you want, but that does not control the show. Don't I know what you're trying to do? I know. I'm on to you, Tom. You're trying to just elbow your way in. Like, this is my show.
I know. Yes, I am so domineering.
You are. You are very.
That's beautiful.
It is.
That is a great
That's amazing,
shot.
Peter.
So, Peter, do you by any chance have a photo of your actual setup? Because I know you are in Australia, but you are not actually imaging from Australia.
No, correct. It's just, I think it's about 9 o'clock-ish in New Mexico. So, yeah, using my telescope there that's on the iTelescope network. And it's I'll just grab a shot of it for you. But this is Orion. And I was actually pretty impressed with that, given that it's only 26 degrees away from the moon. So it's looking pretty good.
Wow. Now, you must be using some filters on that.
Peter, are you using any filters with your imaging setup?
He's muted.
Sorry, I am using the mute button, but
that's okay.
Luminance, it was just luminance 120 seconds. I've got some other filtered shots to show you later, which you might be interested in, around comet sighting spring, where there's a big effort going on down in the southern hemisphere at the moment. But this one doesn't have any filters. It's just 120-second luminance image. So I'm just going to look for a shot of my telescope, which I always keep losing. I'm not sure where it is.
Yeah, I always ask you. You should just keep that on hand. I drool over your telescope. So I just want to share it with the world. Like, this is what makes Scott drool every time I see it.
Well, plus down there in New Mexico, you got really good skies this time of year.
So this is it here. Let's go share. That's it there.
There you go.
Look at that
That's a 20-inch?
Yeah, 20-inch plane wave, yeah. So plane wave have become the preferred, without giving any free plugs, I guess, but they really are a rock-solid platform, and the Ascension mount is very, very good, very stable as well. So.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah, and so you control this telescope from afar, and so you're...
Yeah, well,
in
Melbourne, yeah, so I live in Melbourne. And, you know, if you're around corporate Australia, corporate America at the moment, you'd be hearing a lot of terms like the Internet of Things, the Internet of Everything. There's a lot of things in that photo that are all connected up, and they work very effectively. And, you know, in terms of big data, we're hearing a lot about big data at the moment, and... you know, citizen science and amateur astronomers are really getting into a lot of big data, and everything that Pamela does at CosmoQuest is sort of like a big data. So amateur astronomers are really leading the way in terms of a lot of the creative thinking and energy in this space, and I think it's pretty interesting.
Yeah, it's this is probably the biggest telescope that we ever have in the virtual star party. So it's a
but maybe not for long. I've been
maybe
talking.
Not for long. Yeah,
I've been working on perhaps getting a 60-inch into the VSP. Ooh. I'm working out all the details with the observatory, and I'm excited.
Yeah.
I'm really excited.
Yeah,
it's not only just a 60-inch, but it's a historic 60-inch, and I'm all nervous about it.
But this is really kind of cool, though. I mean, we're at a second golden age for astronomy, that amateurs can do as good a work as any professional for the equipment that they have. It's just amazing what people can do these days.
Yeah, and it's one of the interesting aspects of this is the Mars MAVEN mission is about to is on its way. It's on, you know, it's going to show up at Mars in October, I think, the first week of October, and you've got a $1 billion spacecraft heading to Mars to sample the volatile atmosphere of Mars and how that's been changing over the decades and thousands of years, millennia, and 2 weeks after it arrives there, comet sighting Springs is going to miss Mars by 135,000 kilometers.
Holy smoke!
Yeah.
So, problem being is that if you don't know what the behavior of the comet is going to be as it approaches Mars, you're going to, you know, potentially there's an element of risk there that, you know, the NASA need to manage. So all spacecraft, of course, are designed for you know, protection from particulates in space, but you might not necessarily expect to meet a comet when you get there. So all the amateur astronomers in the Southern Hemisphere are pretty much the only people who can see this comet between now and October, because a lot of the professional observatories are highly tuned machines, and they're you know, they have very specific horizon limits that they can't breach and the like. So it's quite challenging for NASA to understand what they actually potentially need to do about this. Now, there was some time before the mission took off, but where they had some time to plan, it was only about 3 months before, you know, like a 5 or 6 year planning life cycle, that this sort of, they found out that this comet was going to go so close to Mars. So ideally, as the comet comes through, we need to know exactly how much dust it's giving off, so that if they need to do something, they can, you know, do that with some sort of intelligence. So a lot of the amateurs are collaborating at the moment with the professional astronomers. I'll just give you an example of what we're doing. This is the kind of, I think you've got that there now. This is a photo of comet sighting Spring from last week, and you can see that in the B filter, the V filter, the R and the I filter, it's got very different magnitudes. So this is part of how astronomers do the colour sampling of the brightness of things. And it's really interesting. So particularly the astronomers want to know at NASA, you know, its magnitude and its rotational curve and all these kind of things, particularly in V and R, so that they can develop some assessment of how much dust is discharging from the comet as it approaches Mars. So just for those people watching today, 135,000 kilometres is pretty close. To give you an example, the moon Deimos is about 23,000 kilometres from Mars, and the apogee, the highest point of the spacecraft's orbit, is going to be about 6,000 kilometres, and then it's going to dive in and sample the atmosphere and come back out. So there's quite a bit of interest in this, and the amateurs are playing a strong role in helping solve this or manage the risk of this little problem.
Wow, that is amazing.
Yeah.
Just for the folks in the watching this, the RGB and V filters stand for red, green, blue, and visual. So the B filter only shows light that's coming through the blue light, red light, and then well, that's an I filter. I'm sorry, that's infrared, isn't it? And then the visual band. So that's very useful to know. Some of the part of the chemical makeup of the comet, and because certain chemicals will not show up in certain light frequencies.
Yeah, correct. Now, the next shot I've got for Fraser is M78. This is one we don't normally go to, but and this one you can see the moonlight creeping in. I can get my share button back.
We're still seeing your comet.
that's right. I'll get it here.
Well, while we do that, let's hop over to...
Yeah, I've been going back and forth to the moon images. So, yeah, from James and Russell. So that's James' view. And there's Russell's view. Oh, man.
Yeah, that's just awesome stuff.
All right, so... Sterling Gothrop wants to know, okay, astronomers, who was someone who inspired you to want to do science?
That is a really good question.
It's gonna
sound pretty cheap, but especially tonight, but honestly, Carl Sagan really did. We're reading Cosmos and watching it, and I'm hearing lots of crashing from somebody. Yeah. But no, it's some words, just the way that he dictated those words and the way that he was able to communicate in such a way that made you use your imagination while you were also learning something. I think that is a fantastic combination of getting into science, is that you need to use those creative parts of your brain while also learning some of those hard facts. So I will say that even though it sounds cheap and easy to say, Carl Sagan definitely was someone that inspired me for science, and I still look to his work and his writing for inspiration.
Yeah, it was very similar for me, actually. I was trying to figure out what website project I was going to work on, and I was considering a bunch of my hobbies, and I was in the midst of reading Pale Blue Dot by Carl Sagan, and I also had The Case for Mars. Just reading Pale Blue Dot just totally got me excited to actually go and build a website. So Carl Sagan's Pale Blue Dot is probably the inspiration for me doing Universe Today in the first
place. That's awesome. Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I like Candle in the Dark.
Candle in the Dark is what made me a skeptic.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that made me a skeptic, and reading, like I'd always been interested in space and astronomy, even when I was a little kid, but it was reading Pale Blue Dot that got me excited to the point that I was going to make a website about space and astronomy. Yeah.
And I would say someone that's not famous, though, I would say it was my 8th grade science teacher who also ran this nature preserve, and his name is Mike Supernault. And I still remember him, and I loved him because the first day of class, we were there with our textbook, and he literally opens a window and throws it out the window. It says, "We will not be using this. This will not help you understand what's going on." And was very much, teaching us that science is an interactive experience. It's something you had to do, not just to learn. And that's something that really stuck with me. And I love being able to have seeing people react like that to science and realize it's not just a bunch of facts. It's about way of looking at the world around you, and you are an active participant with.
Yeah, that's amazing stuff. I attended unknowingly attended a Carl Sagan lecture when I was in my early teens. High school I was in drove us up to, I lived in a little way south of Portland at the time, drove us into Portland State University to listen to this astronomer talk about finding intelligent life on Earth. And he was presenting slides of cows walking across the pasture as a means of figuring out, well, if you take a picture of this pasture every day at the same time, you'll see these cows walking across basically the same path. Now, are those intelligent creatures or not? It just blew my mind. His thought process on that was just amazing.
Peter, you put up an image here. What is this image that you were showing us?
So that's M78. Sure of its common name, but it's a very blue, quite a dark blue. There's not a lot of things in the night sky that are really blue coming, and you can see the moonlight creeping in on the edge of that.
Yeah, no question.
Significantly, yeah. But it's quite a dark nebula that's across the front of a blue patch of sky. So it's not far from Orion. I think it's in It's more up towards the top of Orion, near Regal, I think. So yeah, it's a lovely one. We don't often cover it in the Star Party. So, and I'm just having a go now at the Horsehead Nebula. So I'll just see if that comes down for us nicely. It's probably a bit close to the. It's back close. Well, it might be all right. We'll see. But my journey was quite interesting one. I sort of left school. Was told I wasn't good enough at math to be an astronomer. Don't be ridiculous. There's only one astronomer in the country. And so I went into electrical engineering and ended up in corporate IT for the last 30 years. And probably about 2003, when my dad passed away, I was kind of reflecting on things as you do. And I came across a citizen science project called was the Fast Moving Objects program under Skywatch. It was the second citizen science project after the SETI at Home project had started. And this one was the next one that was more on astronomy. And I was one of the early adopters of that and downloaded, you know, about 200 images and followed the little mosaics looking for asteroids. And I found one of the potentially hazardous ones that they were looking for. And they changed the parameters on the run this night and didn't tell anyone. And they were amazed that I actually saw it in the image. So... that sort of sparked my interest again, and I went looking for what else was around and came across Fraser and Pamela's podcast at the time. And I remember sitting on a train and Pamela was talking about a water world with, Fraser might remember this, but she made this really funny quote, which was, "We're just waiting to find a water world where we can make a B-grade movie on it," you know, and and that sort of captured my imagination. And I sort of plugged in a bit tighter to some of the things that were going on around citizen science. And then, you know, I'm coming towards the end of my career in IT now, and I'm sort of looking at all the other things, you know, I can be doing, and really enjoying. Being part of the collaborative community of amateur astronomers, and it's great. It's been an interesting journey, probably a bit different to some people.
Now, I'm really curious about James, especially since you're one of our younger astronomers with the group. What really inspired you with the previous question from Sterling? What got you into astronomy and into science and doing things like that?
Always had a passing interest in astronomy, but I felt as though I could never really do anything with it. And then I met a guy that worked on the NASA program for my previous job, and he kind of mentioned that there was an astronomy club in Mobile, Alabama, and he recommended me a guy named Max Harrell that's in the astronomy club that showed me what you could do with a regular telescope. And And then I later on read Carl Sagan's Cosmos and Billions, and this really got me further and further into it. That's pretty much how it happened.
Awesome. How about you, Russell?
Yeah. I don't know if he's got a mic tonight.
Yeah, I know sometimes it doesn't. If not, Russell, try to type and I'll... read it to you in my
weirdest
voice I can. So, my name's Russell, and I was inspired by looking up at the moon through my telescope like you're looking at now. No, honestly, put it in the chat, or you can put it in the event page when we're done. And I also want to put out there, as we're looking through your questions, please no Cosmos spoilers, because I will find you and beat you.
Yes.
Just so you know, I have not watched the episode, and I will find you and beat you.
Yeah, Cosmos for me is right after VSP.
Yeah.
Spoiler, Carl Sagan's not in it.
No, I think he is. At least from what I've heard, but not, I think maybe in a preview. Let's see. Gosh, there's so many questions about Cosmos. And I love that we are many people's Cosmos after party. That's fantastic. I think we should just keep that.
That's a great idea.
Yeah, that's... We should get almost organized about it and maybe, like, actually promote that.
I think we can do that. Let's talk. Cause I have this website that I use, and it has this great name that goes along with what's going
universe
on.
Universe some or other, yeah.
Yeah, and, you know the Cosmos and Universe Today.
Yeah, we're just the guys to do it. Okay, well, let's think on that. Maybe that's a good idea. Maybe we should have gotten more organized. Okay. We can't do all the things all the time.
What? Organize? No, that means we'd have to be professional half the time.
More, pick Peter. More.
Well, I mean, we think you are beautiful, but
we need more.
You want to say, yeah? I was just waiting for that. Let's see what else I've got here.
I'm going to go ahead and keep looking through comments. And actually, while that was a great question, Sterling, especially being tonight, any of you watching, please leave us your answers in the event page on Google+ or on YouTube. Send us a tweet at @_VSP. I didn't post a link to Facebook except for on my personal thing, so if you want to find me on Facebook, I'm Scott Lewis, and you can leave your comment there. But I really won't read it out loud because you shouldn't be on Facebook.
Oh man, are you gonna just keep beating on Facebook again this week?
I will keep smashing Facebook.
Ooh, James has got a beautiful view there. Look at that. So I think we're still gonna do a short VSP, unless
I think so. Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
Yeah, I think we were only supposed to go for 5 minutes, and somehow we've already gone for half an hour. So.
We're talking about Sagan, man.
I know. But
while we're doing that, I'm going to start sharing images from the event page because people are putting some amazing images up here.
Interesting post. So Chet Morton says, talking about Sagan, don't you feel the tone he chose to advocate skepticism so much more useful than, say, Dawkins or Penn Jillette? That's a good question. You know, like when I read Science is a Candle, Demon Haunted World, Science is a Candle in the Dark, he was pretty angry towards, you know, woo-woo pseudoscientists. Right. And if you read that book, he's not, you know, he's really harsh on pseudoscience and just, you know, shows example after example. I think with Dawkins and Penn, they're more focused on the atheism side, and Sagan didn't really cover that too much. He was mostly just focusing on skepticism.
I think his anger
side.
Was tempered as well, as that he focused it and was not just out there, where sometimes emotion can really take control of the current conversation, or you could tell that Sagan was very deliberate with the words that he used quite often. I'm going to do a quick screen share here. This is from Jim Meeker, and this is awesome. This is NGC 3628, also known as the Hamburger Galaxy.
Very nice.
Yeah. So, and that's another thing, too. If any of you do your own astrophotography but aren't able to join us, please put them into the event page on Google+ for a virtual star party. And I will try to pull them up as we go along and show off some really good ones. And I'm using my hands while I talk, and you can't see it, which is even better sometimes.
Yeah. So hold on, let me just push this picture. So Jimmy, you can go back to the picture, Scott. Sorry.
No, me. I'm pretty.
Yeah. No argument here, but back to the picture from
there. Jimmy. We go.
Yeah, what do you think about this? Scott Chapman says, regarding putting photos online, is there any consensus as to whether it's better to leave the picture inverted, or should we flip the image to show the true direct view?
That's an interesting one. Most people put north to the top. I guess there's a trade-off between what you're trying to do in terms of if you're going for a photogenic approach and it's framed nicely at the way you capture it, then I've always left it that way. Other amateur astronomers who want to compare images and measure position angles of tails and things of comets always like for the images to be presented.
Got another one here. Hold on.
To the top.
Oh man, Jim's posting some nice pictures.
Yeah. So this is M1, Crab Nebula. And Jim, if you can comment, let us know what you're using. I can tell that these are yours, but I'd like to know what telescope you're using and also your camera and setup and like that. And actually, where you're at. I'm sure I could look at where you're at. It looks like you're using a C6 by your image, and you're in Illinois. But yeah, I would really love to see what you're using, and because you're really putting up some great images, and we need to get you in live, sir.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yeah, we'll send Scott after you.
I will. I'm not afraid to hunt people down, especially if they do put spoilers into the VSP or talk about the Super Bowl. And here's another one by Jim. I mean, fantastic work. You know, there's a Horsehead Nebula there.
Yeah, that's always awesome to look at.
Here and actually here's another one showing the Horsehead. This is from Perry Arts, and let me share it first before I read the description. So these two views of the Horsehead Nebula were taken with the same telescope, a Celestron Deluxe Edge HD 1100. The image on the left was taken at f2 with the secondary mirror removed and a hyperstar attached, so put at the end of the business end of the telescope. Mm-hmm. And this gives the field of view 79 by 105 arc minutes. The image on the right was taken at f10, so with a longer, which you can tell. So it has a longer focal length on the right-hand side here, which allows it to has the more zoomed, more embiggened of a smaller area, so we can see here, whereas opposed with the shorter focal length, you get a wider field of view. And that's just fantastic. I mean, oh, I can zoom in. Yes.
Ooh.
So thank you, Perry. This is fantastic. And then this, you know, the amazing field of view you have here anyway. I love being able to see all of it here.
This is the awesomeness of CCD cameras. Yeah, you instant results, if anything.
Right. Well, I mean, I have done some astrophotography back in the day with film, and I couldn't imagine ever trying doing that again. I would hate myself if I went back to trying film, because just, and you don't know, you have no idea what's going to happen. You know, you have to time it all right, but. Especially now we have this amazing technology of using, you know, CMOS or CCD. You just kind of have to keep going with it. And you can just like, that wasn't good. I'm going to do another long exposure because I can. I can see it right now.
I just keep going back to the moon.
My horse head's just coming down now, so I'll have it for you in a minute.
Yeah, and there's this guy, James McGee, who's putting pictures in the Hangout while he's in the Hangout. What's going on? That's
pretty skilled.
Oh, okay, so Jim is saying that it's a 20-inch plane wave that the club lets him use.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
That's
in Central Illinois.
Now, this here is by this James McGee fellow, which I don't know if we trust, because I only seen his moon. I've not seen any full-on...
And you're a total ninja, so you are posting your live view of the moon, James, and then you're also posting in your pictures?
That's right, on a Microsoft Surface using Internet Explorer.
Is that even possible? What?
My
How about
goodness.
That?
Please tell me you're using AOL dial-up. And
yes. Of course.
And this is all hosted on a GeoCities site.
Homestead. Oh, get it right. Jeez. Oh,
yep.
Okay. Well, here we go. Oh, so God. Peter's got his horse head. Oh, neat.
Now, it's one of the interesting things about the horse head, and I don't know if you can see it here. I'm going to zoom in a little bit. There's always satellites going through. I'm not sure if it's geostationary satellites or what, but I very infrequently see a copy of the horse head that doesn't have a satellite tracking through it. I don't know just if that's where it is in the sky or whether it's because... it's getting low in the west, and it's still early in the evening. You know, we often see this, but so just to give you a perspective, this is a single 300-second frame, so it's actually quite dark. So to get the image as good as what you just saw, there's a lot of processing goes into that to just gently build the signal to noise and lift the depth of field out of this image. So you can quite clearly see the head there, but you don't get the same sense of colour, obviously, because this is just a monochrome camera and a single filter. But you can see the dust lane through the back there. It's quite stunning. I just got booted off my telescope, so I had to log on to another
one. Off of your own telescope?
Oh, my.
I am closer than you. If you fly me out to New Mexico, I will take care of it for you.
So, no, someone had a time-sensitive observation, so I just jumped on one of the other ones and grabbed it.
Ah, very good. Well, here's another.
Scott's posting another picture here.
So this is from Jeff.
Jeff Troppiano,
Troppiano from Denver Astronomical Society, and this is his Orion Nebula.
Look at that.
42, and I am going to zoom and enhance.
I want to give a shout out to Jeff. He's been emailing me and asking for some information. So an amazing picture, Jeff. That's fantastic.
The thing about Orion is it's so very bright in the middle near the triangulum there, and which is the little set of really bright stars that lights up most of that. And often you see, because it's so bright, people get a lot of light and capture it. And, I'm not criticizing people, but often I see people have really detailed images that almost are over-processed to me. And I love the soft, gentle photos like this that are taken by amateurs. They're just so nice because they just show you actually what's there and in the true colors of it. And great job there.
Pulling out the darkness, which really shows that contrast, which I think is very important for what's going on here with this being a stellar nursery.
I like the soft pastel Orion.
That is just so cool. It looks like a bull on the side.
All right, I'm going to go back to Russell's moon. Man, we actually got a lot of people watching us tonight. Just to apologize to everyone, this is not your normal virtual star party. We're running sort of half speed tonight.
We did not expect a full show, then all of a sudden it's happening, and we had to play catch up on actually getting the video embedded places. But it's been awesome, and thank you everyone for your contributions, because I will totally screen share that and get them shown out to you. Which also means if you can do this stuff, you can be in this show live, and we need you.
Wouldn't it be cool if people could contribute pictures from the Q&A? App?
That would be great. Fantastic.
Oh, yeah. God,
yes. And we could just share them into the... I wish we knew some people there we could suggest that kind of thing to.
I know some people we can talk to. Yeah. I'm sure you do, too.
Yeah. Okay, well, you know what? Why don't we wrap this up in, like, 5 more minutes? Now, Peter, you've lost control of your telescope. We've got James is down. We've got one view of the moon. I think it's time to wrap this up. So, Scott, why don't you and I talk over this week? We'll figure out something clever for next week for Cosmos, since we're going to be endlessly trailing behind them week after week. I'm going to be on Hornby Island next week.
Okay.
So,
what are you doing Tuesday?
I don't know. We'll talk. We'll figure it out, man. But next week I'll be actually on Hornby Island.
Oh, nice.
Broadcasting from my parents' place. So
nice.
Yes, Fraser. So one of the things that a lot of the amateurs are working on at the moment is Mars, because it's up guy. And I know Mike Phillips is doing a bit of work on it, and a number of the other planetary images have got some amazing shots of Mars that I've seen in the last couple of weeks. Because it's coming around to the point where it's close to Earth again, so they might be good people to plug into that one as well.
Yeah, there was a picture of Mars that I posted onto Google Plus, onto Twitter, and you could see like clouds above Olympus Mons. Just a beautiful picture.
Right, that's fantastic. I love being able to see that.
Yeah.
They've got individual clouds over individual volcanoes at the moment.
Yeah, the Mars volcanoes are still alive.
Bigger, angular, its angular arcsec and sort of diameter is getting bigger every night, and they are really giving it a shake.
Yeah, totally. Okay, cool. Well, I think we'll wrap this up then. So, hey, thanks, James. You've gone dark. I don't know if you can still hear us.
Oh, he's there. Sort of.
There he is. Oh, he's going back.
There we go.
Well, thanks a lot for jumping in, and thanks for sticking around, even though we told you that we weren't going to be sticking around. And Peter,
thanks for bringing on the battery just died.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense. Thanks for bringing on the plane wave. We really appreciate that. And yeah. Russell, I'm sorry we can't hear your dulcet tones, but thank you so much for bringing us that moon. That's absolutely fantastic. Tom, Nathie.
Yes, sir.
As always.
Thank you.
I don't know how many times I got to tell you, clean your office.
Yes.
Oh, come on. A clean office is a sign of a sick mind.
That's true.
Yeah. But yes, it does need to be decluttered.
I do want to say...
Thanks for jumping in, and thanks for rolling with the punches this week.
I want to say hi to all the new watchers of the Virtual Star Party that met at Science Online last week. Welcome to the awesomeness on Sunday nights. Please share the word. I'm seeing a lot of new people already tweeting out and stuff like that. So, awesome. And if you know anyone that wants to join in as far as any astrophotography goes, let us know. Get in touch with us. We're pretty easy to find on Twitter, Google+, and that other place with the blue. Yeah, some face, whatever. But let us know. And we would love to work with you and get you involved.
Absolutely. I mean, if you can get a telescope connected to the internet and you can get pictures from your telescope onto your computer, it's pretty easy from this point on, and we'd love to have you join us. So
we'll work out the tech details. We'll get you set up.
Feel free to contact either one of us. You're at Scientific Scott on Twitter. What's Scott at Know the Cosmos?
Scott@knowthecosmos.com is my email address. You can find it on my Google+ profile.
And I'm info@universetoday.com. So, hey, thanks everyone for joining us this week. Sorry it was kind of weird, and we'll get something organized maybe for next week with Cosmos. And thanks again to the astronomers for kicking around and bringing us these beautiful views. So we'll see everyone next week.
All right.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.